Welcome everyone back to Seminar Excellence in English Program Management, Making EP Work Sustainable and Impactful. This session is another interesting one that we're all looking for. The panel discussion includes Ms. Lynn Margaret Brow, guidance teacher from Strisuksa School, Mr. Tobias Classen, English teacher from Udomdarunee School, Mr. Tracy Lynn Powell, English teacher from Yothinburana School, and the last speaker is Mr. Julius Cano Pacheco, mathematics and computer teacher from Somroiyod, Wittayakom School, and last but not least, our moderator, Mr.Sumaetin Saengtriratnukul, EP Media Project Manager from Aksorn Education Company Limited. The topic that they are going to discuss today is Foreign Teachers' Voices for EP Education Management in Thailand, Determination, Inspiration, and Positive Thinking for Sustainable Development. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming our panelists and moderator up on the stage.
Good morning, everyone. I am Sumaetin Saengtriratnukul from Aksorn Charoentat. I am the EP Media Project Manager. Well, as the title of this panel discussion say, Foreign Teachers' Voices for EP Education Management in Thailand, Determination, Inspiration, and Positive Thinking for Sustainable Development. Well, it can't be denied that foreign teachers play a crucial role in making English program happen and actually work. Despite all the challenges, we have here with us our panelists whose years of teaching in Thailand have proved to us that they fall in love with this country, and with teaching Thai students, of course. Well, today, as our topic suggests, I'm more than certain that we can learn a great deal from them, and why they stay, and what they want to tell the EP managers here, along with other inspiring story. So I would like to start off with a brief introduction of your school, if you may, and then we move on to our discussion. Well, if you are ready, okay. Our first panelist, Ms. Lynn Margaret Brown, guidance teacher from Strisuksa School in Royet.
Good morning, everyone. Oh, come on, you are teachers. Good morning, everyone. Thank you, thank you. Okay, I teach at Strisuksa in Royet. I have been there since the program started in 2004. I have a short video that I would like to show you, but let me tell you first. This was designed for an international visit that Strisuksa made to Malacca, Malaysia in July. Strisuksa has been part of the Strategic Education Alliance of Southeast Asia as a founding member for 2 years now. And this is an international opportunity for students to go abroad. In 2017, we are scheduled to be the host. If you like what you see on the video, contact me afterwards because we will be looking for visitors to come and see us in 2017 when we host the international. Please, if you would show the video, thank you.
Strisuksa is a government secondary school located in Royet Province, approximately 550 kilometers northeast of Bangkok. Our school is situated on 25 rai, or 10 acres, conveniently located on a main road just south of the town center. The campus is comprised of 6 academic buildings with additional support buildings, a sport field, 3 sports courts, 2 meeting halls, a canteen, and other associated facilities. Current student enrollment is 4,174 students, with an administrative and teaching staff of 230. As a government school, we are obligated to follow the Thai Basic Education Core Curriculum 2008. All core subjects are taught in the Thai language, along with many electives. The national curriculum also includes activities for student development, such as Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts, Girl Guides, Red Cross Youth Club, and numerous other clubs. Uniforms are required apparel in high schools. A student's cut of hair and style of dress indicate they are a lower or upper secondary student. Education in Thailand at government schools is free. Students are required to attend school from age 6 to 15, although students usually attend to age 18. A typical school day begins at 8 a.m. with morning ceremony. The ceremony includes the raising of the Thai flag, accompanied by the singing of the Thai national anthem. All are then invited to join in morning prayer. Announcements to the student body, recognition of awards, and other important matters are then discussed. Students are typically dismissed from ceremony after 15 minutes. First period begins at 8:30 a.m. Eight periods of 55 minutes are scheduled each day, with one period for lunch. There are no free periods or study halls included in the Thai school schedule. The day ends at 3:50 p.m. This is a Monday to Friday schedule. Strisuksa is recognized as one of 500 world-class standard schools in Thailand. One innovative feature of these schools are the specialized programs offered to students. We have two such programs. The Gifted program features advanced studies in language, mathematics, and sciences. And the English program is a bilingual program with the emphasis on learning subject content in English as well as in Thai. English is a required subject in the Thai curriculum. However, many students do not gain proficiency in speaking English, mainly due to their limited exposure outside their classrooms. In 2003, a national program was begun under the title English Program. Strisuksa began this specialized program in 2004. A major goal of the English program to have core subjects taught by native English speakers, as well as those core subjects taught in Thai by Thai teachers. However, the funding of these programs would not be provided by the government. Thus, English programs throughout the country are tuition-based programs. To qualify for an English program, students must pass an entrance exam and possess an aptitude or interest in English. The school day is also extended by 1 or 2 hours, and often Saturday classes are mandatory. A student may study in the English program for 3 years in lower secondary, 3 years in upper secondary, or for 6 years in college. Our English program has developed several international study tours to motivate students in their English studies. In 2013, we took a group of students to Singapore, where we toured Nanyang Girls' School. It was during that visit that the C-Square Conference was first mentioned. Our school director was interested in the project. We are proud to be among the founding members of the C-Square Conference. This year, we are attending Malacca with a team of 4 students, teacher chaperone, and 2 members from the founding team from last year. We believe that to represent Thailand C-Square Conference in the future, more schools in our country need the opportunity to participate. To move this initiative forward, additional members of our administration need to be aware and involved. So, we have 3 additional team members attending this year, including the school director. Thank you for the opportunity to share this with you. We hope you will all accept this invitation to come and visit the English program of Strisuksa for yourselves.
Thank you very much. That invitation was issued, as I mentioned, to the group that went to Malacca, Malaysia, but it applies to all of you as well. If you would like to visit us in Royet, please do so. I represent a team of 14 foreigners in the English program at our school, and my comments today will reflect some of their ideas. But I have a request from them. I want to take back a picture of all of you. So on the count of 3, would you all wave to me so I can take your picture, please? Ready? 1, 2. No, I cannot. Okay, I have to do 2. Okay, 1, 2, 3. Yeah, and 1, 2, 3. Thank you all very much.
Thank you very much, Lynn. That was really entertaining. So our next one, Mr. Tobias Classen, English teacher from Udomdarunee School in Sukhothai. Please.
I'm going to stand up. I don't have a lot of information about my school. In fact, I was very curious, what am I doing up here? Because I, especially having met some of you and seeing your great experience, your years of teaching, and your love for students, I think what it qualifies me to be up here. I think it's because I've been a teacher at my school for a long time. And my program, in fact, I am the youngest of the teachers in my program, okay? Not the youngest in age. I mean, I've been there for the least amount of time. Other teachers have been there for 14, 15 years. So our youngest teacher in our program has been there for 6 years. So we have good retention, I guess. In addition, okay, so Udomdarunee School, we're in Sukhothai. We have three classes, M1, 2, and 3, with about 30 students in each class. Okay, we have consistently high and improving ONET scores, and that's in every subject. Higher than national average by a great deal, higher than our school average by a great deal, and every year a little bit higher. Not that that necessarily means that we are the great success, but we feel that we are. We have always more and more students trying to get in. We have parents clamoring, begging us to open M4 to 6, which we haven't yet. And again, we have great teacher retention. So I feel that we're pretty special. But in preparing for this, I had the question, I asked my coworkers, what is it that makes our program special? And we feel that we are special. And we have this idea, if you've heard of the term magic bullet, and that's my drawing of a magic bullet. A magic bullet is like, if you know werewolves, the silver bullet to kill a werewolf. Or a magic bullet is the idea of one thing that's going to change everything. The idea of big history is the same. We have the idea of great people, a great person that makes their civilization great. You know, is it a great leader? Is it, you know, a great Westerner? Is it a great curriculum? Is it, you know, amazing students? So I want to go through a couple of things that maybe are part of that magic bullet, because I think, in fact, there is no magic bullet. The fact is it takes a mix of many things, and maybe it takes all of these things, and I'm sure many more. Respect. Why do teachers stay? Because we feel respected. And that's, again, verbal and nonverbal, and there's a lot to say about that, but I think, just in short, that is basically how you keep a Westerner. How you get a good teacher is another question, but how you keep a good teacher is to give them respect, which can be very difficult sometimes with different cultural values. And so tolerance is, I think, probably the quality that you all share in dealing with Westerners, because cultural differences, of course. Westerners enjoy conflict, some of us. We like to share our strong opinions. Some of us can't control our tempers or can't control our frustration when we feel slighted. I know this has been the case for me in the past. And intolerance is something that is necessary and something to be encouraged in us as well, of course. Tolerance for the things that we don't like about Thai culture or the way things are. And then, of course, tolerance by Thais for us, for the way we are. You know, just as an example, if you know, our meetings at our school, I remember we got a new boss, and she sat in on one of our meetings, and her eyes were like saucers, like, they're arguing. Should I step in? Should I stop them? Should I say stop? But she was good. She stayed calm. She let us talk it out. And by the end, we were all on the same page. But we do conflict, and we speak more directly, and sometimes too directly. We can't accept things the way things are, which I think for a lot of us is a sign that we care, but can still seem like we're insulting you, or we're coming after you, or we're saying there's something wrong with you, you know. And then, of course, we like to just say something that bugs us, but we don't think we can change, and we don't really want you to, don't expect anything from you, and so on. So, conflict assured, there will be conflict, and misunderstandings. So tolerance is one of those things I'm sure is part of the magic bullet. We need a strong defender. We have one, and we have had one. And this is kind of an interesting thing, because I see isolation as one of the big problems for EPs. So how do you have a leader who defends your Westerners, defends their outbursts occasional, you know, and protects us from whether it's gossip or whether it's commentary or concerned parents, you know, why is my son not doing so well? Why is my daughter not getting good grades? You know, go after that teacher. And we need that defender to say, wait, let's deal calmly with this. And frankly, I'm sure there's comments that I don't hear, bad, you know, bad things that I don't hear because my boss doesn't think that I should. She thinks, you know, better have the positive feeling and the feeling of togetherness and family over reporting every, you know, every concern that comes along. Direct hire. This is something we do at our school. I know just talking last night with some of our panelists and some of you, this seems to be a linchpin of effective English programs. I came to Thailand with an agency, like many people did. We did not get paid over break. Many Westerners do. But many Westerners that work for agencies don't get paid over their break, or they get paid half, whereas the agencies are keeping that money. And so there are, and not to say all agencies are predatory, but there are predatory agencies. And direct hire is part of that feeling of respect that I get from my school. I get hired directly by them. They deal with my paperwork, and I get vacation pay. You know, so those little that is a big deal for me, and especially talking to other Westerners in Sukhothai, there are abuses. They're everywhere in the agency system. So if you can recruit for yourself, a common workroom, again a commonality between English programs that feel successful or claim success, is you have a workroom where the Westerners can be together with ties. Not, you know, don't kick the ties out, but a workroom that feels like family. And of course, let it be a students' room as well. At our school, we have our computers in the teacher's room, our student computers, that is. And we tell the students, this is your room. Come in. Be welcome. And of course, we have a library next door to us. I'll get to that in a second. But basically, we get open discussion. We get conflict and resolution. We get to live with each other. So if we have a problem, it's going to come out. We share news. We share... course resources, and that's a book, by the way. That's a bookshelf, and then that's a bookshelf in somebody's head. So, resource library, whether it's literature, many different, you know, textbooks and so forth, and of course the teachers and the, you know, I had my first boss in Thailand. She, or in the EP program, sorry. She would all the time be bringing books to me. Would you like this book? Does this help? What do you think about this textbook? What do you think about that textbook? You know, comparing and looking, and she was showing her concern for education, for English education, but it rubbed off on all of us. You know, she would get a new textbook and bring it. She would get this book and bring it. She would bring books that were probably older than she was, and she was pretty old, and she would bring them and show them to us and give us ideas. And this is a really big deal because it helps us keep this communal vision. Also, my own pet topic, literature. Students should love books. I think without that love of books, they're never going to get very far in English, in my opinion. And so have those books for them. Have things to read. And even have programs to encourage their reading. So we've been pretty lucky. We actually got a library filled up by donated books from the U.S. And this comes to another question of how we got those. I think it was just an email, like a single email. And then they said, like, oh, we got a bunch of books, and they just sent them to us. Communication, of course, speaking expectations clearly, scheduling. I'm sure most Westerners have had this, hey, no class tomorrow, or what are you doing here? There's no class today. And we go, oh, all right, cool, I guess, right? So communication is a big part of it. Humor. Now, I want to specify humor for the sake of humor, being able to laugh at yourself and others. There's a kind of humor that probably does not belong here. I have a couple examples of humor. There we go. There's a kind of humor that I would warn against, which would be the kind of humor where you are actually making a comment or criticism with that humor. Westerners, at least I like direct comments. So let your humor be humorous rather than pointed. Okay. outreach. And this, if I could say one thing, I think, again, like I said, isolation, this feeling of isolation, both for Westerners can feel isolated when they're in an English program, but even English programs themselves can seem isolated. And I think they have to fight that isolation. English program directors, which many of you are, you know, look for opportunities for your students. A few years ago, our EP director sent an email. It was just an email. She found online an application process to be part of a disaster preparedness program hosted by Japan. She sent an email. They invited us to send students, English-speaking students, and they went. But she was looking. She was looking for that connection outside. As Lynn said, you know, getting those connections outside is a huge deal. Whether it's connection to universities or a connection to, you know, sister schools outside of the country, or even just cooperation between English programs, getting that outside influence is huge because it lets you have a vision out that's bigger than your own vision. You know, you get to see the ideas of other people. You get to see the way they do things. You get to discuss our common vision of elevating English in Thailand and elevating education generally. The way we accomplish it is by working together and talking together, sharing inspiration. An old eccentric person. I don't know, maybe this is part of the magic bullet. If you are the old eccentric person in your office, then we love you so much. Never retire, please. I don't really know, but I thought I'd include it because we do have an old eccentric in my office, and he's amazing. He's amazing. And maybe it has something to do with tolerance. Maybe it has something to do with cultural differences. He's old, so no one will say anything to him, you know. He has a bit more freedom, because freedom certainly from criticism. But to be himself and so forth, we give him more room. I think the Thais give him more room to be himself. And so I think there's kind of a lesson there about the kind of tolerance we are capable of. Anyway, I love the guy. Of course, there is no magic bullet. It's really a combination of all things. And I would like to personally thank Aksorn for hosting this and thank all of you for being here. I feel really honored. I felt just so much inspiration just listening and talking and seeing how we all agree and we all are on the same page. So, you know, maybe that's the big thing. Let's get together. Let's talk. Let's share ideas and inspiration. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Next, our English teacher from Yothinburana School in Bangkok, Mr. Tracy Lynn Powell, please.
Thank you. My name is Tracy Powell. I'm from the U.S. I've been working in the English program at Yothinburana School for about 9 years now. I'm sure many of you have heard of Yothinburana. We are the first, and we're kind of a mentor school, so many of you may have visited us before. I'm kind of that old eccentric guy now. You know, after 9 years, the teachers, new teachers are getting younger and younger, and I'm the old guy now. But I'm very lucky to have, when I first came to Thailand, to end up in this school. I didn't know anything about it at the time, but now I realize how lucky I was. And I think I've developed so much as both as a teacher and just as a person in my time here. I think we have a video now to show of the school. Okay, it's not available. So there won't be a video, but I have a lot of things that I'm proud of when it comes to the EP, especially regarding foreign teachers. In order not to repeat myself, though, I won't say it right now. I'll wait until our discussion. Okay, thank you very much.
very much, Tracy. And last but not least, our mathematics and computer teacher from Somroiyod, Wittayakom school in Prachok, Kirikan, Mr. Julius Cano Pacheco.
Yes, good morning to everyone. Good morning to you. Good morning to you. Clap your hands, teacher, go. Good morning, good morning, good morning to you. My name is Julius, and I am from the Philippines. And I have been working, and I have been working in Somroiyod since 2548. It's like 10 years. 10 years and 3 months, like that. So I am going to present to you. Let's warm up. Everybody's like sitting already. You've been tired of listening to us, yes? Everybody say, clap one, clap two, clap three, one, two, three, Aksorn! Okay, one, Aksorn. Okay, one, two, three, go. Clap one, clap two, clap three, one, two, three. Very good, very good. So, I'm going to give you a short presentation of our school. So this is our school in Pachuwab Kirikan. It's like 250 kilometers from Bangkok. It's like 3 hours. And then, it's a very Banok school, a very Banok Maglir Habib. We have only 1711 Kit Dudi. And we have only one Lotus. Lotus is Lotus Express Ik. The very small Mac, very small Mac. So it's very difficult for us to find foreign teachers. And where's my presentation? There you go. There are around like 1,500 students and 93 English program students from M1, M2, and M3. And there are 9 foreign teachers. And also, Mr. Anutinaruwat is the person who had established the English program of Somroiyod. And thinking that Somroiyod is a very district, rural area, he has this vision of building a very small program, and now it's become an English program since 2004. And then currently we have Mrs. Tan Tip Sang Hong as the acting director of our school, and then Mr. Jerome Mokburut as the assistant director. The vision of our school is upholding competitive students following the virtue of sufficiency economy. And the program's identity is that if you say Somroiyod Wittayakom Government School, it is an organization with international linkages and commitment to community service. We are not just an English program raising doctors, teachers, nurses, but we want our students to be responsible citizens of Thailand. And then we have also the student's identity. When you said student from Somroiyod Wittayakom School, they have like keng pasa klasadeng ok. Yes, that is our keng pasa. They should be good at English, but they can also confident on speaking the English language. And then also we have, this is our EP staff, was being managed by Mrs. Sangwan Jang Lamun, and then the 3 Thai teachers that we have. And the foreign teachers was being headed, of course, by me, and then Miss from Uganda, Philippines, England, Philippines, and Australia. And we have 2 Dek Fuxon, two student teachers from the Philippines too. So there are 9 teachers. So the English program, once they have already admitted, we are going to organize a 4-day orientation camp, which these all students, they come from different Pratham school. So what we're going to do is to make them aware or to make them be friends, or make friends with their foreign teachers and their new friends like this in our photos. And our foreign teachers are giving them games for 4 days. That's before the start of the formal school year. And then we have also, once they have a month after studying in the English program, we are going to encourage our student to join the English program clubs. And these clubs are, for example, we have speaking club, public speaking club, and then we have also acting club, we have dancing club, we have singing club, we have also spelling club and writing club. And we have one of the best things that we have in Somroiyod is peer teaching. our teacher, foreign teachers, help each other. One teacher is going to teach and the other teacher is going to observe the class, and they will give inputs of how you teach, and then they will give feedback. It's always like this. We have always peer teaching once a week in Somroiyod. And then we have also individual performance. Our students are being observed informally by our foreign teachers. Our foreign teachers also go to different houses of our students because yamban, they visit yamban, kru farang ko yamban. They go to different houses of the students so that they will know, they will understand why this student behave like this in the class. Why he's been very talkative. So when we went to his house, the student was kept krota, kept katana. So we understand him already. It's like a formal, an informal. And then after that, we have also AP Science Spelling Bee for M1/1. After 2 months of studying sciences, of science of M1, M2, and M3, we have AP Science Spelling Bee, all science vocabulary for them. And then we have also EP Open House. All of you know this already, but I will be very fast with this. And then English conversation. After this English EP conversation, we organize for second year M2 students. We invite all the parents because the parents paid 18,000 baht per semester. Thuktisut nei prathet mang. Is there any cheaper than this? 18,000 baht per semester English program. ไม่ มี แล้ว ใช่ มั้ย ครับ ต่อ แรก 15,000 มัน ไม่ ไหว 18,000 baht. So I think this is Somroiyod English program is the cheapest English program that we have in Thailand, all over Thailand. 18,000 baht per semester, 36,000 baht free. Free books, free notebooks, everything is free. You want bicycle, we will give you bicycle, like that. So you just come to our school, like that. And then we invite our parents to check. The students will be in front of the stage, and then the foreign teachers will be there, and then they are keep for 5 to 10 minutes, they will have this conversation. That is how the parents will test if the student riyan kumay. Kumay, moon pad, kumay hab, kum. And then we have academic camps. These academic camps is that we have this like a three-day camp, like mathematics, science, and like you have also in your school. And then English training course, we also train our students for different, this is another English camp, but this is an English training course, intensive English training course, with games, of course. And then we have also Halloween party. This is last year we have the angels and demons, different like a parade of ghosts and angels and demons in Somroiyod Wittayakom school. And then we have also Christmas party for them to relate with the culture of Western people. And then we have also academic day. Academic day is like an open house of Somroiyod where we invite Patom schools to go to see. And then we have this place like Sangtong Praapaimani in English. So yeah, we have this kind of shows. And then EP exchange program, of course, like everyone, you have exchange programs to different countries. Like we have shows in the Philippines and then New Zealand. And that's it, two countries, because we don't have money. and then we have also MOU, the Memorandum of Agreement. The Memorandum of Agreement is that we have Awatapu College from New Zealand, Sophia School in the Philippines, Bulacan State University in the Philippines, St. Mary's College of Mikawai in the Philippines, and Valenzuela School of Mathematics and Science in the Philippines. And we are trying, this year we are trying to organize an MOU with China and Australia for this year, so I hope we can. And also, community service, it's one of our highlight of our program. We build, we make our students keng pasak lasa deng ok, but we also, you have also to help the community. By helping them, we teach English for teachers, we bring our EP teachers and EP students to help the English Pratom teachers and Matayam teachers in Area 2 and Area 10 of of the Ministry of Education, and then also some of the schools come to our school for personal training, and then English for villagers, Muban. We help our Muban to speak English too. Muban, Banok, they can speak English. Where is 7-Eleven? You go straight, turn left. Okay, goodbye, thank you. That's how we teach them the English. And then because of this noble effort that we've been doing, Channel 3 came to Somroiyod and cover us and then help us to fund more and help more and encourage of helping the villagers to speak English. And then we have also English for nurses, because there are 3 farang in Somroiyod, so they need to communicate. They need to communicate. So the nurses of Somroiyod ask our help to teach them English, like a high blood or like how to get the blood test, something like that. And then English for officers of Area 2, officers of Area 2 and Area 10, we help them to speak English. And then English camps, like we have organized English camp from different schools. So it's all for free. One Saturday, free English program for them. May tong jai le kap. Falang ko may mitang kap. Diba? Nong Chacham School, and then Pak Nam Pram Wittaya School. And then the last year, this is the last, this year, Miss Teen Thailand 2015 was from Somroiyod Wittayakom School English program. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Julius. And this panel discussion has just been turned into a talk show already. So I have to be a moderator of a talk show, actually. So, first thing first, I heard from some of you, but some of you may have not mentioned it yet. Could you please tell us how many years have you been teaching here in Thailand, and how many years at your present school? If you please.
I've been teaching in Thailand 11 years, and I have been at the same school 11 years.
I've been teaching in Thailand for 9 years, at my school for 6.
Wow.
And I'm the youngest.
I guess I already answered this, but I've been here for 9 years and at the same school.
Wow. So. How about you?
10 years and 3 months, same school. Yeah, only one school.
So this is the that leads to my question. Well, there has to be something that keep you here, keep you at your school. What are the fun, and what captures your heart and makes you stay at the same school for this long? Lynn?
I asked my fellow teachers about this, and we all agree, it's one of the things. Is that moment when you see the light bulb go off in the student's head. They've not understood, they've been just not paying attention, and suddenly something has clicked and they got it. They understand. They start to ask questions and get involved. And for us as teachers, that makes it all really amazing and worthwhile. I remember our first year, we had one student, she came to me in her third or fourth year, and she says, you know, Teacher Lynn, the first year, I really didn't like English. Oh, really? Yeah, I really didn't like English. Why were you in EP? I wanted the air-conditioned classroom. So I asked her, well, what happened? She said, I don't know, something with conversations with you and the other teachers, and I began to understand English, I began to enjoy English. She graduated her M6 year the top in the class for the English program because she really applied herself. Those are the kind of success stories that make us stay.
I think her answer pretty much covers mine. Seeing, but it does. No, it's seeing students come out of their shell. You know, they're so shy in the beginning. Just, and in M1, maybe that's learning to say, what is something, or ask a question, instead of just saying, I don't know, or being silent. For me personally, I love to see their writing. I'm a writing teacher, and of all the homework I grade, most of it is not, well, I'm a grammarian, or how do you say, not a grammar Nazi, a passionate grammarian. And so I correct all of their journals, you know, by hand, and every comma, every capital letter. Despite the fact that their essays look like they're bleeding after I'm done with them, I'm always amazed at their self-expression, at their humor, at their growing, you know, self-confidence, and that's such a reward for me. So,
Tracy?
There are, of course, many frustrations in teaching. I think teachers anywhere in the world sometimes think, I'm wasting my time. They're not paying attention. They're not learning. Why am I here? But sometimes, I teach M1 normally, so I get them when they're young and cute and nice. It's kind of downhill from there, but sometimes I don't see them again after M1. But years later, I'll talk to a student and they'll mention something that I talked about in class. And maybe it's a little thing, but it shows me that, yeah, maybe they really were paying attention. Maybe they really did learn something. And it's just everyday things like everyday interactions, talking to students before class, after class, or outside of class. You know, just talking to me as a normal person, in English, of course. Maybe it's something, a phrase they've learned, and they're just practicing it with me. So it's little things like that that makes it worth it to me.
Thank you. Julius?
The reason why I come to Thailand is I want to travel. And after I graduated college, I want to go to Thailand for a year and then go to Japan and then Vietnam for another year to teach mathematics. But Somroiyod really spoiled me. At first, during the first year, I said, this is my last year. I will end the contract already because I am planning to go to Cambodia. The head of the program said, okay, we will go to Cambodia. So we all go to Cambodia. And then I have another second year. On the second year, okay, are you going to stay? No more, I want to go to Laos. And then we go to Laos until every at the end of the second semester, we go to different countries. That make me stop here. So the two factors affecting my stay here for me personally is, one is motivation. Motivate your teachers, extrinsic and intrinsic. It's like financial, or it could be, you can motivate them. Second is also the workplace. The reason why after 5 years I continued to stay, because one of my students said, teacher, I want you to teach my children. So I stay. I will wait for his children.
Thank you very much. Well, sometimes we are mixing up with the words motivation and spoil. So they are spoiling you, okay? And well, from what I've seen here is that all of this come from the passion for being teachers. I mean, you say this is some kind of rewarding feeling that you've got every day, like talking to students after class, like, you know, seeing them growing up and then accomplish, and then after don't like English, but graduate top of the class, oh, come on, that is so rewarding. Great. However, well, in both dimensions, I have to ask this, teachers and learners, what are the challenges that EP has and how can we solve them? Well, you can answer that separately, or you want to, you know, tell us the challenges, okay? Lynn?
Our team came up with two major challenges. The first one concerns communication between the teachers, the core subject teachers. We know that Thai national curriculum changes, but sometimes as foreigner, we weren't brought up to date with the change. Or a core subject teacher may feel that the progression of topics doesn't quite fit this semester and they change. And our goal has been for the foreign teacher to try to coordinate their teaching with the Thai teacher. Sometimes that doesn't happen, and the students get confused. My Thai teacher's talking about this, and my foreign teacher's talking about that, and it creates a problem for the students and the teachers. So it comes down to communication. We need to have a representative within the Thai staff who is bilingual and can help us with the translation, because most of the foreigners do not speak Thai, and most of the Thais do not speak English. So it's a problem where it can be fixed, but it takes some extra time and patience to just explain what each other's doing. And the other problem, and all of you can help offer suggestions on this, but it's copying. You give your student an assignment, they go straight to Google, Bing, whatever website, and whoop, copy, paste, hand it in, teacher. And of course they gotta add all the doodads and knickknacks and things to make it all so pretty. Isn't it beautiful? Well, yeah, but do you know what it says? No, but isn't it beautiful? They're more concerned with the presentation than the content. And the teachers can tell immediately at looking at it, you copied. Word for word, mistakes and all, you copied. But what is the discipline for that? What is the problem? We cannot fail a student. No student fails, right? No student in Thailand, to my knowledge, has ever failed. They've got to be passed somehow. But how do they learn that copying is not accepted when they see it in other elements of society? So it's a complicated issue, and we would welcome suggestions on how to fix that one.
Please, Tobias.
That's a difficult one. I mentioned one of the ones early that we talked about, isolation. I know some of you have the support of your directors and so forth. At our school, the science and math program is the darling, and we are kind of left out on our own, which is, again, why it's very nice to have a strong EP director. But she does her best to reach out to other institutions, other organizations, to find opportunities for our students. But we still feel isolated, and I think this is one of the problems. Certainly also the concept of Westerners coming in anew, and how to find new Westerners, how to deal with all the paperwork. If you don't have an expert on the visa process at your school, you know, what do you do? You know, do you go to an agency? Do you look for somebody, or do you let the Westerner fend for themselves? I think all of those happen in turn at different places. So that's a problem that we feel. And I think it's something that we could probably very easily address. Certainly universities, I wondered about this sometimes, because when I was growing up, we had a university day and career day at my school, where universities would come and kind of recruit and share their programs. It's something I don't see in Thailand, but I think it's something we should see. The English programs and English departments of universities coming, and I asked around about it, and they said, oh yeah, all we have to do is invite them. I said, well, let's invite them, you know. Another problem, I think, as Lynn said, is motivation. Student motivation. How do you motivate students? Many of them, their parents say they will be doctors, and the students don't have their own motivation. So that is one of the problems I see really facing the learners is there. And the problem of no failing is a problem of motivation as well. Even the problem of no failing causes motivation problems for your leading students in a class, because they say, oh, well, what is my 4.0 worth if nobody fails? What is my homework worth if I don't have to do it? Maybe this isn't a problem we could really address that much, but or maybe it's just a question of remedial work, but it is definitely a problem of motivation. Okay.
I think the idea of an English program is a bold one. Teaching your curriculum in a foreign language. I think that's a pretty bold idea, and I think it's largely been effective. But there is one issue that my colleagues and I have discussed before, and it's motivation also, but specifically motivation to use English. They're getting this exposure to English in the classroom throughout the day, but that's not enough. You know, they actually have to practice it. They have to use it. And why would they do that? How would they do that? I think it's an inherent weakness of an EP in Thailand. They're Thai students. They live in Thailand. They're going to speak Thai. I don't know if we can fight that. We've discussed it, and we haven't come up with a solution. We've thought of things like, you know, English-only policy at school, but that's really, practically that's unenforceable. We don't have an answer for that, but I think it's a very, very big problem. They're getting this knowledge, they're being taught, but they're not putting it to use. And if anyone has any ideas, anything practical ideas, then I would love to hear them.
I believe that the backbone of the language proficiency of Thailand are the EP managers. And your backbone are your foreign teachers. And if there will be miscommunication going to happen, if there will be communication barrier between or among foreign teachers, or between Thai teacher, between the EP manager and the foreign teachers, there will be problems. One of these problems is miscommunication. And the Somroiyod staff has overcome this communication barrier by using the EP meeting every Wednesday. All of you have this schedule, yes, of EP teachers meeting, yes? Use that. You don't have that kind of meeting? Okay. I'm sorry. So we have this every Wednesday, period 8, we have this EP teachers meeting, and we are going to talk to the foreign teacher, what is the problem for this week? And how can we solve this problem for this week? And if the problem keeps on repeating, the EP manager should come into the class. Communication must be observed. And also, if there will be like 2 minutes or 2 seconds, a minute before change of schedule, there should be whiteboard in your rooms, in your staff room. And then I write a very big announcement: there will be no classes this period 7, shortened periods, like this. That's it.
Thank you very much. So from what I've seen here is that communication and language barrier. I mean, you guys mentioned that it seems to us that the message from the, you know, principal directors hasn't really come across and delivered to you, and then something, you know, mixed up. So, well, this is one thing that I think our audience would take away with them, is that communication matters. And that is the key, because of course language is different. You speak one language, they speak another language, and then boom, the message disappeared. Okay, great one. I can see that Lynn mentioned about the students, and then in regard to them, for more than a decade here, what kind of development have you seen in the EP program in the students? And what are the points that has some room in it that you think that we should improve?
For our EP, we had some problems with cheating on tests. We solved it by mixing our classes during midterm and final exams. So for example, we have an A and a B classroom in M1. Half that group is going to study with a group from another level so that the person sitting next to them is not taking the same test and can't share any answers because they're from somewhere else. It has helped. It has helped tremendously to do that. It takes a little coordination, but we got it together and that's going well. Another thing, though, that has been a problem is the activities. Sport day is coming up for us. How about you? Got sport day coming up? We have sport day in December. How much time is being spent on activities to prepare for sport day? In Pasa Thai, Mai Thai Pasa Angkit. So activities, they're important. We know it's part of student development. But we would really like to see some adjustments made in when and how much time is being spent on those activities, because it really cuts into the classrooms. So that's one thing. It has improved. This term, we're trying to have shortened class period. Communication again, Monday it didn't work, but last week it did, so it's a day-by-day thing. Those are two of the main things that we came up with.
Okay, as far as improvements at our school, I would almost say what seems most significant is not a big deal, but our Thai teachers in the English program, they speak English with the students. And it's a big deal. Now the funny thing is, I'm sure many of you, like our Thai teachers, love to say, my Thai is so bad, or my English is so bad, my English is so horrible, oh, I speak incorrectly, oh, I don't know, I don't understand. But it's great. It's great. And it's good enough to speak with the students. And it makes a big difference. Because, I mean, seriously, just like 5 years ago when I came, it was Westerners spoke English and the Thai spoke Thai. And then our EP director she's the one who started the process. She says, you know, we can't enforce everything. We can't make them speak English all the time, but we can speak to them in English. And so they started doing it, and it made such a big difference. Our office and our library, they are English zones. And we don't enforce it, really. The students still speak Thai to each other. But when they come and talk to us, they understand that no matter who they're talking to, they're speaking English in our office. And that's been a really big improvement. Another improvement we've had is in the addition of reading resources for the students. We just purchasing new textbooks, but especially purchasing reading books for the students. This was kind of my own push. I really wanted to have books in their hands that they were reading every night, and writing resources and so forth. On top of that, we've had parents, where we had a parents meeting like when my first year there, and it was very sparsely attended. But now we've had both parents come out and support, and then we were kind of lucky. I don't know if you have the same deal at your schools, but our XEP students organize an orientation for us. And so it's been interesting to see how the older EP students have come back and been like, you know, welcome to the EP family. And they host a party now every year, a reunion of EPs. And so we've really seen just kind of the congealing of influence, and the students really feel that they've become part of a family. So that's been pretty special.
Earlier, Tobias mentioned exclusion being a problem, foreign teachers feeling like they're excluded. And we had some of that. But some years ago, the head of our EP brought in a coordinator just for the foreign teachers. And the first two maybe didn't work out so well, but the one we have now is foreign also. She is qualified, she's very much respected, and it's really made a big difference among the foreign teachers at our school right now. We feel like we're included, that we have a voice, and someone who's on our side, and I can't explain how big a difference it's made us feel inside, and I think that's reflected in our teaching also. So I would urge everyone here who's in a position, get someone who can, you know, take care of your foreign teachers. Not just anyone, it really needs to be a good fit. So someone who is respected and qualified and can really bring people together. Like I said, it's probably the best thing that's happened to our EP, and I'm very happy for that.
Let's admit it or not, our students have all problems. And one of the problems that we had, during my presentation, I said that once you have mentioned Dekso wo Dek Samroiyod, you're going to say they are klasading or keng pasa, but wichakan may dai reung, they're not good at mathematics, equations, they're not good at it, fractions, operations. So what we did is that every Saturdays we organize a free tutorials in Thai for the Thai teacher to follow up the lessons for free, mathematics and science. Yeah, that's our problem there.
I see. Good you mentioned that, Julius. Just hold on to the microphone.
Oh my God.
And do I have to translate that from Thai into English?
Okay.
What can we do to improve EP education? Well, it seems to be the problem everywhere. I mean, Tobias School is exception, is an exception, because you say that the audit score is keeping going up every year. But some of the school has the problem that the thing that this student hasn't got really good scores in, you know, ONAT and everything. So what can we do to improve EP education to better the student's academic achievement? Can you give us some idea of that?
Okay. The problems, how are we going to solve the problems in developing the achievement, the student's achievement? EP managers, you have that power to control your foreign teachers. And those foreign teachers have that time. They have that time to connect with those students. If they are weak at mathematics, then have this special program for them. If they're not good at English, why don't you organize a special activity for them? So those, we organize different activities to cater the needs of different or various needs of different students.
How about you, Tracy? Any thoughts?
I think there's a saying, happy wife, happy life. It's directed toward husbands, of course. If your wife is happy, then your life is happy. Well, I think happy teachers equals happy students equals successful EP. And I know this is, I'm kind of repeating some things that have already been said. It's kind of the theme of today, I think. But if you can take care of your teachers, then I think that will filter down to the academic performance of the students. That would include, already been mentioned a lot today, communication, of course, but just listen to the teachers in general. No one knows the students better than the teachers. You know, we see them all the time, we talk to them, we know them. So I think we have some good advice in general and even regarding specific students who might be having some problems. So, you know, definitely listen to your teachers, and also, it's been mentioned already, including your foreign teachers. Make them feel part of it. Maybe not all the time. You don't have to include the foreign teachers in, you know, two-hour meetings and held in Thai language only, but you know, make them feel at home. And I think if they're happy, then they will be better teachers, and it will filter down to the students.
Thank you very much. Tobias, how about you?
I don't want to just echo what's been said, although it's absolutely true. So I'll add one thing. I think that we need to expand our EP families to include each other's families, whether it's education, higher education, coming to our assistance and helping with our visions, whether it's sister schools, whether it's outreach to other English programs at schools near us. I think we need to be making those connections. I think that maybe could be one of the biggest differences for us. Certainly not to replace dealing well with your Western teachers or your foreigner teachers, because they need to feel at home and respected, etc. I would add one thing. I think open house needs to be revisited, this idea of peer competition between us. I think that we need more cooperative activities between English programs that bring our students together, bring our teachers together, rather than putting the students in front of a panel of judges with no audience, with no support and no feedback, which I think has become the norm for open houses. Our open houses, I think, have become disastrous in many ways in this sense. And that would be one of the things I think that could make a huge difference in building an EP community rather than isolated pockets of English use.
How about you, Lynn?
This one might step on some toes, but it's something that our teachers feel very strongly about. If there were more uniformity within the testing process for application to EP for passing the application, or I'm sorry, passing admittance to EP, and then final M6 testing, what's required for university. Now, part of this is beyond our control, and it's beyond your control as EP heads too, because the school director and administration makes final decisions about who will be admitted to EP. And since EP is a paid tuition program, we all know that many times we have students who are admitted into EP who simply can't afford to be there. The student doesn't want to be, their fellow students don't want them to be, but the parents feel that it's the best choice for a at-risk, behavioral, or otherwise problem child. Those particular children pull down the classroom. They pull down the academics. And if you have a child who is well motivated and they want to get that 95 to 100% on all their test scores and they get the GPA of 4, and they're with a student who's got passing 79, okay, we'll push them to 80, so they got the GPA of 4. What happens to the motivation of that really qualified student? So we think this is a problem, and this whole situation needs to be looked at and evaluated nationwide. What can be done to improve that process?
Okay. And I think four of you here could be the best persons to tell our audience, because I heard that some of the audience are starting their EP program at their school, and this is one thing that they are struggling with. Well, if the resources provided are limited for schools which is started EP, what are your suggestions for them? How can they do that? Lynn?
Speak. Thai teachers, speak in English. Foreign teachers, speak in English. Let your Thai students know that as a Thai, you are proud to be able to speak more than one language. Let your students know that as a foreigner teaching in Thailand, you're happy to be here, and encourage them. But speak. Don't rely on your tablets and all the other things. They're all great, but we don't all have them. Speak.
Yeah, amen to that. You know, I wonder, I know many of you have been outside of Thailand and studied abroad and so forth, but I'm from California, where my high school, actually almost 60% of my high school were speaking English as a second language. And they were all American. Yes, they were Chinese American and Japanese American. They were all American. And I think this is very true of a lot of Western countries, is that English is not spoken perfectly. It's just not. We hear it and we understand it. And so I think we need the motto, and this is, you don't need money for this. You just need to have the willingness to speak English. The motto being, all English is good English for language learners and for language speakers, you know. You will not learn English by reading if you don't use it. You will not learn English with PowerPoints and amazing teachers if you don't use it. And you teachers, your English is so good. It's good enough. And if you can't, on the negative side, if you can't dare to use your good English, how can you expect students to use their new English? That's where we begin, and that's going to be the biggest difference. Other than that, scholarships, look for outside help, lower costs, in any way you can, I suppose. How do you start an EP program without money? I guess you just need a lot of belief and vision and hope. And I think there's a lot of that in this room, and certainly a lot in Thailand. So it's possible.
I'm going to say, put your students first. They're first. That doesn't mean they always get what they want. Sometimes they should get what they need, not what they want. Okay. I think maybe the students of EP should be told that they're in a special position. Not that they're better than anyone else, but they are in a special position, and encouraged to use the situation they're in to their best. Using the language, really learning something, not just having fun and getting through the day. Just make them feel special, because they really are. And they're going to be the future business leaders, et cetera. They really are. So just make them feel special.
All schools here have Filipino teachers. Those who have Filipino teachers, please raise your hands. Okay, thank you very much. So for those who will start their English program, this will be an ending battle. It's like an ending argument of who are you going to hire, a native English speaker or a non-native English speaker. Let's say, for example, you are in a van and your student will go inside the van. The driver will, let's say, for example, from a native, like a good driver, but who doesn't have a license. The other driver is a good driver too, but has a license. Who are you going to choose? The license or without the license? Okay, so the problem here in Thailand is that we are very artificial of choosing the teachers, which I understand, of course. You're having an English program. Of course, you're going to hire Farang, Nenon Yuleo. That's why we understand, all the Filipinos here in Thailand, the Association of Filipinos here in Thailand, understand that we are going to teach mathematics and sciences and health. We understand that. We need the program, need Farang for that, for promotion. And you also need non-native English speakers who are hard-working teachers. Think of that one teacher in your mind. One teacher in your mind who stay in your school for more than 2 years. What motivates him? What motivates her? Think of that foreign teacher. Is he a native English speaker? Is he a non-native English speaker? We don't care. As long as he is dedicated to your work, as long as he is dedicated to your job, as long as he is willing to give all his life for your school, not for your school because it's not your school, but for your students. That's all. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Well, this is something that I think most of the audience would like to know. You are from other countries. What are the differences in learning habits of Thai students compared to those abroad? I mean, language is one thing, but how about the learning habits? Because I'm sure that the EP manager will go back to that school and use this kind of information to help manage the program. So, Julius, you, okay, go on.
I teach mathematics since 2004 and 2005. In that generation one, I teach the Thai students. They are very good. They ask too much questions. But generation 13, kikiet ma. Sut เลย they are very lazy แก้สมการก็ไม่เป็น x บวก3เท่ากับ5เขายังไม่เป็นอ่ะ What is happening? Is it because are you going to blame the foreign teachers or are we going to blame the Pathom teachers? Who are we going to blame? Are the parents going to are we going to blame the parents? ปัจจุบันนี้เด็กไทยแบบขี้เกียจมากเลยครับยอมรับไหม It is.They are very lazy. Are you agreeing? Maybe that's like 75%. 25%, they have that intrinsic motivation by themselves that they want to be best. They want to be someone in the near future. But for the rest, especially in Somroiyod, they have, teacher, what are we going to do with English? We plant pineapples. So the problem that we have is for Thai students, you all have seen that difference, that disparity, that change from old Thai to a new high-tech Thai student, and it is very, very alarming. มันน่ากลัวมากเลยครับสุดๆ
About a year ago, I interviewed some new Mathiom 1 students, and one of the questions I asked them was, what makes a good teacher good? And most of them gave, you know, typical responses like a teacher who doesn't give homework or gives free time or plays games, things like that. But one student said, understanding. And that really hit me. You have to understand your students. And it's been a long time since I finished school, high school. But I still remember. I remember a lot. And I often compare the way things were then to the way the students have it now in Thailand. And I understand, at least to a point, why they copy things off the internet, why they cheat, why they don't do their homework. I understand. I just looked at this exam schedule, midterm exam schedule of my students. Mathiom 1, they have 19 subjects. 19. When I was in school, I had maybe 8 maximum, 7 or 8. I went to class every day. I had the class every day. If I studied art, I studied art every day. If I studied math, I studied it every day. It was easy to keep up with your studies. Sometimes, Thai students, some of their subjects, my subject, one of my subjects, fundamental English, it's a fundamental subject. It's only 3 times a week. That's less than 3 hours a week. Some of their subjects, they only meet once a week. And if sports day gets in the way or something like that, maybe you don't see them at all that week. So they have so much on their plate right now. It's so different from when I was in school. I don't think I could do what they're doing now. So I'm not excusing the cheating and the copying because I get very angry also. It is inexcusable, but I have that understanding. And this is a huge problem, I think, that no one in this room can solve. This is not something that the head of an EP can deal with. This is much, much higher. I won't mention the government agency or anything like that, but it's a serious problem and it affects the students dearly. And hopefully there will be enough pressure put on the powers that be to make this better or solve this problem.
Tobias?
Yeah, I would have to agree. I think some of the biggest challenges are systemic. But I chose, when I came here, I thought, let's talk about things that we can do something about. And so I like the idea of the big difference that I see, aside from obviously these huge differences of the number of classes they're having, the number of activities taking them out of class, absentee teachers, things like that, that we have no control over. To talk to you or answer this question with the concept of literacy, what I see is a core concept in education in the United States, which is where I'm from, and in Korea where I've also taught, is literacy. Not necessarily reading only, but cultural literacy, or the idea that here is an ocean of knowledge. Please dive in. Please love, you know, exploring in this questioning and concerns and doubting and open communication, but certainly, you know, reading as well. But I think right now what we have is we have this ocean of knowledge, and we're sending the kids over it in a high speed boat with a teaspoon. You know, get some knowledge quick, get it quick while you can. And I don't think this is the core of education that we need. We need a core of education that has higher education as the goal for students that are going that direction. But certainly, you know, not just a little understanding, but really getting into the depths and understanding that the knowledge they're going to get is a foundation, and not an end in itself, right? You don't learn geometry to know geometry. you learn geometry to grow yourself and your thinking capacities. You don't read a book because then you've read a book. You read a book because it changes you as a person. It makes you a different person. It opens your mind to the minds of the author, opens your mind to the minds of the culture that that book came from. And I think that we need to remember this. Literacy, cultural literacy, and general literacy, and all these subjects is something that, that takes our love of our subjects as well. And hopefully the systemic changes or the systemic problems can be addressed as well to allow for that better to occur. But we, you know, students, like Julia says, it's alarming. Students are playing computer games when they get home. They're, you know, they don't see, you know, maybe 1 in 20 students enjoys reading in Thai or any other language. And I think that we need to address this in all of our classes, you know. Getting a good job does not ensure happiness. It's self-improvement and a love of life and a love of learning that's going to give them happiness. And a love of hard work, of course. We can model that for them, hopefully.
Okay, I know, I see the sign. Time's up. So what we tell our teachers is that Thai students love to have fun. That's true universally, but it seems to be more true here. So keep lessons fun and informative while they're learning at the same time. Thai students are not so individualistic. They don't like to do things by themselves. For example, they won't even go to the toilet by themselves. They've got to take a friend. Okay, so the same applies when they're doing a project, but let them choose their own workmates and give them something to do that's creative. The creativeness of Thai students, when you give them the freedom to express themselves, it's amazing. They might be quiet in speaking in other ways, but give them something to do with their hands. It's amazing. Those are some things that we see that are different that teachers can use in the classroom.
Just before we open for a Q&A session from our audience, one last question. You have 1 minute. If you want to, is there anything else you wish to tell the EP manager here? What do you want to say? If you have 1 minute to tell them.
My heart's too full to say that all in 1 minute. I appreciate the opportunity that I've been given to teach here in Thailand. I love the department head that has just retired from our school, and yes, there's some anxiety about the future, but I appreciate very much this opportunity, and I'm very glad that the Ministry of Education opened this up to foreigners to be teaching students here in Thailand, and I hope that it continues.
I guess just, you know, thank you for the work that you do. You know, something I remind my daughter sometimes, that you can be happy and sad at the same time. And I think with Westerners, sometimes we complain a lot, or we you know, express disapproval with this or that. But for me, and I'm sure for my other panelists here, like, we are very grateful for the work you do and for trying very hard to take care of us. And certainly, you know, Thailand education is improving, or the, you know, English education is on the rise. You know, we have very, very bright horizons, if you will, and it's thanks to your work and your dedication. And you know, don't get depressed about the hardships. You know, just keep pushing through, and address each problem as it comes along. And we'll see great improvements in Thailand and in our students, and those rewards that are so satisfying, you know, the smiles and the students that come back to tell us of their exploits in the world.
I'll repeat a few things I said already. Put your students first, communicate with your teachers, listen to them, and include them. It works. The head of our EP did this, and it has made a big difference. It's the reason I've been at this school for 9 years. So I really wish that you would think about that and try to do that. I think you'll be successful if you do.
Okay. Since that every one of you are all EP managers, and being an EP manager is very difficult. It's very difficult to handle Farang. Farang ko ngingao. And then a lot of problems. But you have to get that inspiration in your heart. Ask yourself, reflect that, have I been a good EP manager? Am I being fair to my co-teachers? Am I handling this organization well? Ask yourself about that. Ask yourself, internalize. You need to ask these questions so that when you come back to where you work, you will be satisfied that I have done something for myself. You need to get back that inspiration because you have too many problems already. Too many problems that jala ok leo, may wai leo. But you need to have, like, you are the future of your English, the English proficiency of your students depends not just on us, on the Farang teachers. It also depends on you. You are the driving force of this institution. Get that inspiration back and be happy serving your nation. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was inspiring. Well, right now, do you have any question from the audience? มีใครมีคำถามอะไรอยากจะถาม panelists ของเราไหมครับ Okay. So, if we don't have any question from the audience, I would like to conclude this panel discussion. And I would like, on behalf of Aksorn Education. Oh yes, please. The microphone is just over here. Okay.
Can I politely disagree? Not in the mainly, yes, you're absolutely right. I think there are instances where I speak Thai, and I do it in the classroom occasionally, just for simple things like I'll tell the students to use the phrase, what is, and the word in Thai, if they don't understand, if they want to say something and they can't say it in English because they lack a word. Or, of course, to ask what is an English word, and I can tell them the meaning of it in Thai. Not only that, but to a certain degree, the idea of kind of rejoicing in a second language. You know, they know that my Thai is horrible, and I think that it emboldens them to speak English. But yeah, I don't think that you need to have a zero tolerance rule for Thai in the classroom. I think rather you set the standard. We speak in Thai unless we have a good reason. And you know, I can do something that many English teachers can't do. I can say a word in English and say, what does that mean in Thai? And when they answer, I can say yes or no. Or I can say, what is this Thai word in English? And they can answer. So it gives me some opportunities to quiz them. Now, I do not consider that as a departure from immersion teaching. Which I think is absolutely important, essential, even.
I see your point of, like, the students will get lazy because it's like I speak English and I speak Thai. In the classroom, when I teach in the class, all period, I try to speak English as much as possible. But how will you explain to a Thai student or to a group of Thai students abstract or concrete words like responsible? Yes. Like, for example, the word responsible. How are you going to explain that to your students? For foreign language teachers, we are all foreign language teachers. Foreign language teachers, they said that grammar translation method It's a method that is very good approach for your student to comprehend what are you teaching. Grammar translation method is a very good approach of teaching. I'm not saying it's for me. For me, it's a very good approach of bringing the message to your student. It lessens the teacher talking time, and it has given you the opportunity. Like for example, responsible dekdek means rapi shop. Responsible. Say it again. Responsible. So the students relate to your teaching. It's maybe all the English teachers knew the direct translation method and the grammar translation method that I'm talking about.
Are you calling for a zero tolerance of English in the classroom? Right. See, I don't... I think that's commendable. I agree with that, for sure. And this is something I tell the Thai teachers as well, our Thai English teachers, that it doesn't matter if you're gonna finish a page in a day or a paragraph in a day or a sentence in a day, if you are having a conversation with your students in English. And I think that's very well said that is the case.
Thank you very much. So I would like to conclude this panel discussion by thanking you on behalf of Aksorn Education. I want to thank you, Julius, Tracy, Tobias, and Lynn. Okay. So please give them a big hand. Thank you.